So what is the core idea behind this epistemically neutral concept of theory? Well, most of the outplaying definitions of the concept of a theory that we've seen say something true about theories, like the fact that theories are offered as descriptions of the world that are intended to explain some set of observable phenomena. This is the core idea. A theory is a claim or a set of claims that is offered as an explanation of some aspect of the natural world or some set of observable phenomena. Now, as a first pass, this is fine. You can see that the definition is neutral because it makes no reference to a theory being good or well-supported or well-tested. What matters is the function that a scientific theory is intended to serve, and that function is almost always tied to the goals of explanation and understanding. We construct theories as part of our efforts to explain why the world appears the way it does, to better understand the world. However, if you want to dig a little deeper into this concept, I want to alert you to some pitfalls that you can fall into, especially if you've been exposed to some of the philosophy of science literature on theories. And that's because philosophers of science have been preoccupied with understanding theories as objects of knowledge. When do we have good reason to believe or accept a theory? What counts as evidence for or against a theory? And these questions are tied to the goal of objectivity. We want scientific knowledge to be objective in some sense, but what does this mean? And if it is objective, what makes it objective? Historically, our efforts to understand what scientific theories are have been tied up with our efforts to justify or ground the objectivity and the knowledge that is captured in those theories. And this has led to a certain way of thinking about theories, which I'll now present, but which I'm shortly going to criticize. Here's a commonly made distinction that we can all agree is important for science. It's the distinction between the world as we experience it and the world beyond our experience. One way that we talk about the world as we experience it is to focus on how the world is revealed to us through sensory experience, what we can perceive and observe and measure and detect, experience through our senses. We often use the word empirical to describe the world as we experience it. An empirical fact is a fact that can be verified through sensory experience, or is accessible through sensory experience, or is in some way grounded in sensory experience. We also use the word observable and the word phenomena to describe features of the observable world, the world of experience. The word phenomenon actually just means appearances. It's what we're aware of in experience. We talk about observable phenomena in science, and that might sound redundant, but it's a reminder that the appearances that we're concerned with in science are appearances that are observable, and in that sense, they're publicly accessible to a suitably situated perceiver. Now, we contrast the world of appearances, the world as we experience it, with our conception of the world beyond our experience, the world that lies behind the appearances. That's what goes in the column on the right. So how do we talk about this world beyond our experience? Here's one way. We contrast what is observable with what is not observable, or at least not directly observable. The world beyond our experience is the world of entities, events, processes, structures, regularities that are not directly observable. The key idea that connects these distinctions to science and to scientific reasoning is that in science, we acknowledge that we don't have direct access to these elements of the world beyond our experience. By definition, we have to infer the existence of these parts of nature from the observable phenomena. We use the concept of a theory then to talk about these aspects of nature, the parts of the world that go beyond what we can directly verify through observation. Theories are our attempts to describe this world, or at least parts of this world. So according to this way of thinking about it, the distinction that really matters to the meaning of the epistemically neutral concept of theory is the distinction between what is theoretical and what is empirical, or what is theoretical and what is observable. We infer the existence of theoretical entities or processes or laws on the basis of evidence and experience. The reasoning is basically this. Given what we know about the observable phenomena, we can ask, what description of the world beyond the appearances best explains and predicts the phenomena that we observe? The better a theory is at explaining and predicting the phenomena, the more reason we have to think it's true, or approximately true. So the direction of logical inference is from the observable to the unobservable, but the direction of explanation is from the unobservable to the observable. We explain the appearances by positing theories that go beyond our experience and showing how those theories entail or predict or otherwise help us to understand the observable facts of experience. So this is one way of unpacking the core idea behind the concept of a scientific theory in its epistemically neutral sense. Now, I want to go back to the point I made earlier. My point was that this way of thinking about theories, in terms of the contrast between what is observable and what is not observable, was inspired by these deeper epistemological questions about the nature of scientific knowledge. Is scientific knowledge objective? What makes it objective? What makes it authoritative? This picture that I just laid out gives an answer to these questions. The objectivity and authority of scientific knowledge is grounded in the objectivity of observation, of what is objectively observable. You and I may prefer different theories, but we should be able to agree on the observable facts. That's how observation and experiment can successfully adjudicate between competing theories. And that's how scientists can be persuaded that a particular theory has been confirmed or falsified by observation and by experiment. So that's the picture. Now, having said all this, let me say a few words about the strengths and weaknesses of this picture.